About 10 years ago, I was devastatingly hurt and wounded after a nasty divorce, which had left me as a single mom to a 5-year-old boy and with a strong conviction that I was absolutely finished with men. Celibacy was my solution, and ahead waited only the pension. Against my will, however, I met a man, my soulmate. And I felt wonderful together with him, and we felt fantastic as a couple. We were lively, energetic, focused, in the middle of promising careers, having a great social life. We were full of trust in ourselves, full of trust in us. I saw myself as a strong woman standing next to this very masculine man. He had 2 boys at 12 and 13 from an earlier marriage, and we decided to unite and create an identity of our new blended family, having a baby together. So I got pregnant, he proposed, and we went on skiing holiday with our 3 boys to spend some time together before the baby arrived. The Alps were thrilling and beautiful. We had a great time, though I didn't ski much, being 5 months pregnant. We had been there only 4 days, when just before lunchtime, my telephone rang. It was about my husband. He was in an ambulance heading towards the hospital in the valley. "Come directly," they said. When I arrived at intensive care, I was met by 3 doctors. They explained that my husband had got a severe stroke in his right brain hemisphere, that he was totally paralyzed in the left part of his body. He was highly confused, his brain was swelling, and overall he was in a critical state. I stood there listening to the doctors who were talking about the years he had to spend in rehabilitation, and it didn't make sense to me. In my stomach, literally, I had the future. A future that depended on a present reality that I understood. But right there, in that moment, the present that I knew had disappeared. He was in a really bad condition. Apart from the physical damages, which were significant and visible, and therefore easy to understand, he also suffered from some invisible psychological changes. A strange consequence of having a stroke in the right hemisphere is so-called anosognosia, a condition in which a patient with a disability seems to be unaware of its existence. For example, one evening, when I was about to leave the hospital to go to bed at the hotel where I was staying, he said, "Honey, can't I come with you? We might as well spend the time creatively. Let's make it a love vacation." I looked at him. "But Lars, you can't walk." "Don't be silly. Sure I can. I just have to take it slowly, one step at a time." But he couldn't walk at all. He couldn't stand. He couldn't even sit without help. When he finally left the hospital and came back home, it became incredibly obvious what we had lost. In familiar surroundings, it was right in our faces. The one strong, dynamic couple that made things happen had become unbelievably slow. The days passed by more or less focusing on making safe trips to the bathroom. From the wheelchair, pants down, to the toilet, from the toilet, pants up, back in the wheelchair, helping him keep the balance, making sure he was safe. It was as our life had turned into one long visit to the bathroom, listening to the dirty toilet water flushing out. Though, after a while, he became a little better. He left the wheelchair, and he was able to be present at the happy moment when our daughter was born. A new daily life began, and my days were packed. I was cleaning, changing diapers, fixing laundry, shopping, cooking, doing the dishes, packing the car, driving the car, unpacking the car, arranging family dinners, going to work, making decisions. I had all the responsibility, and I was nervous, worried, exhausted. All the things that used to make life enjoyable was missing. No sex during late hours. No, could you take care of the kids tomorrow while I am out with my friends? No future plans with a longer perspective than basically overcoming the next day. I wondered, was I a woman or a man? Husband or wife? Mother for everyone? Slave of circumstances I wasn't responsible for, like being trapped in a snowstorm where nobody can come to a rescue because of the bad weather? I didn't know. So I worked hard to get us back on track, so I could be the woman I knew and we could be the couple I missed. In a way, I also suffered, like my husband, of anosognosia, not willing to realize what the stroke meant to our life. Family and friends asked repeatedly about his progress. When will he be able to use his left arm again? When will he gain better balance? When will he be less tired, less confused? When will he no longer be epileptic? Are you sure you're trying hard enough? We heard about something very useful, laser therapy, magnesium supplements, acupuncture should be very good. And we tried them all. But it didn't happen. He didn't get well. We did not become ourselves again. After some years, I got this very buzzing sound inside my head. It woke me up at night time. During the day, it made me dizzy. It was as if a big jet was constantly taking off inside my head. Sometimes I even felt I couldn't breathe and that there was no air left for me. Some of you might recognize the symptoms of stress. One evening, sitting at the dinner table with my family, the sound in my head and the lack of air got so strong that I had to leave the table, leave the apartment and go outside, trying to breathe some air. Suddenly, right there and then, standing on the doorstep, breathing, something happened. A new thought came to me. What if he actually is well? What if I just can't see it? Because I define him being well based upon what he was able to do before his stroke. What if this comparison prevents us from living a happy and fulfilling life? I wondered, maybe we are exactly where we are supposed to be with our new given circumstances. I walked back inside, looking him straight in the eyes, saying, "From now on, you are well." So, what is this? Just a matter of positive thinking? The buzzword of this decade? No, I don't think so. It was not just a thought. It was more like seeing the sun rise after a very long, cold, dark night. It was a feeling of deep acceptance. Until this moment, I had dreaded our situation and therefore denied the consequences caused by the stroke. And not being able to accept these changes had made me feel powerless, which had kept me in anxiety and stress. Understanding this made me stop trying to change the physical circumstances and instead beginning to overcome my inner challenges. I changed from being fearful into being open and courageous. It was a revelation that made me trust uncertainty and start believing in my power to handle adversity. I think there are so many moments when we are challenged by life. Maybe you lose your dream job. Maybe you did not get accepted into the university you thought crucial for your future. Maybe your partner gets older quicker than you do. Many life-changing situations are caused by circumstances you have no influence on. You may recognize this. Think about the word rehabilitation. When my husband got a brain injury, the first word I heard was rehabilitation. to restore the person to his former condition, as the Oxford Dictionary defines it. As quickly as possible, he should regain his former abilities, come back to normal, because the status quo is not. Actually, the whole family went into a sort of rehabilitation, where we strived to be what we knew, what was familiar and certain to us. We tried to be the ones we knew as ourselves. Of course we did. It's a part of our emotional biology, holding on to the well-known. We humans feel calm and satisfied when there's nothing uncertain to fear. I think this is decisive for why we find hardships so difficult to handle. That when life hits you, our reaction is to search back towards the well-known, towards norm, towards life as we know it. But at the same time, it's exactly this reaction that stops the process of getting you back on track. So, what happened at home? We started thinking rehabilitation as a journey towards something new, embracing the uncertainty. Before we focused on who we were, now we began focusing on who we are, and slowly life changed. We started staying late up at night, maybe sharing a bottle of wine, talking about life. We did not talk about illness. We talked about everything else but illness. We talked about who we are and what we wanted to be. We redefined ourselves again. And now, being two healthy adults at home, we also started sharing the different responsibilities that belongs to family life. Though I still did most of the domestic chores, my husband did what he could, and without me asking if he needed any help. The dread in my head slowly disappeared. I became able to breathe again. Anxiety disappeared. Worrying stopped. Today I'm much more present in my life than I was before stroke hit our family. I'm right here, right now, using all my moments. I actually became mindful in this process. And I think that's kind of funny, because normally your husband getting a stroke isn't exactly the way we are taught to get into a mindful state, is it? Nevertheless, this is what happened. When I sit beside my husband, drinking coffee or red wine, I'm just enjoying life. And I still have a crush on him. To me, he's sexy. He has a sexy limb. And when he grabs my butt, I feel sexy too. When we fix or build things at home, I'm the one holding the screwdriver, and he's the one telling me how to use it. I carry heavy things to the attic because I have the strength, and he doesn't. But I don't worry about it anymore. It's just the way things are in our family. It's the new normal. So, what I learned is this. Being secure, satisfied, and happy isn't correlated with the ability to look at the positive aspects of life. Actually, the opposite is the case. Facing struggles and tough feelings gives you the opportunity to make them useful, and maybe even to be a gift. When you stop trying to avoid the hardships that definitely comes along, and instead begin to face them, daring experience life as it is, you will become more open, courageous, and satisfied. Based on this experience, I am no longer imprisoned by my wishes or expectations to a certain outcome of the future. I don't fear the uncertainty, now knowing that it is in my power to handle the adversity. And I hope, having inspired you today, to welcome the uncertainty in your life too, whatever it brings. Thank you.